Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to The Daily Blue. I'm Jason Galka, and today I'm joined with a very special guest today, Rohan Murphy, who's here, right here from Long Island, actually. And what an incredible story he has to share. You may even recognize him from his interviews on 2020, ESPN, and even CBS. He's somebody that was born with a rare birth defect, which had left him with no legs by the age of 4, and still he has gone on to be an inspiration to many. Good morning, Rohan. How are you?
Good morning. Thank you.
Great to have you. Pleasure.
Great to be here.
So I'm very familiar with your story because, as I said, I've seen it on CBS. I've seen it on 2020. And this really is a great story to share with everybody out there today with The Daily Blue. Now, tell us about your birth defect that you were born with.
Well, basically, I was born with my kneecaps on the opposite side. When I was born, my legs were backwards. So at the age of 4, I had my legs amputated.
Wow. So what was it like for you at that age to go from, you know, knowing that you had legs and then at that point they weren't there anymore?
Well, for me, it didn't become really difficult until I got to maybe around 8 years old, because I was homeschooled for the first couple of years. Then once I started going to school every day in third grade, that's when it hit me. That's when I realized I was different.
Wow. So you weren't able to go run around with kids at lunchtime and recess, soccer, football?
No. See, one of the big things that I missed out on were sports growing up. Mm-hmm. I really wanted to play little league sports, travel soccer, but unfortunately, I couldn't do those type of things.
Wow. So what was that like for you? Like, I mean, I remember one interview you had said that, you know, kids were going after school to go football practice or soccer practice, and you were left with nowhere to go. What was that like for you?
It was difficult because I really truly just love sports. That was my passion, and not being able to play sports just really put me down and really just put me in another place, and I wasn't really happy growing up when I was younger.
But then shortly after, something else had turned around. There was a coach that saw something that you say you didn't even see in yourself.
Yeah. My 8th grade phys ed teacher, Ron Croteau, at East Islip Middle School on Long Island, New York, he changed my life forever. He introduced me to the sport of wrestling. I began wrestling, and my life totally changed after that.
Wow. So when he approached you with it, I mean, did he say, you know, I want you to wrestle, I want you to become a wrestler? Like, how did the conversation go?
Yeah, you know, Coach Crowder one day came up to me in phys ed class, big smile on his face, comes running up to me. He says to me, Ro, I think you should try wrestling. I look at Coach, I'm like, huh? Wrestle? Kids with legs? He's like, yeah, I want you to wrestle. And I ask him, Coach, if I don't have legs, how in the world could I wrestle? He said, well, you have to go out there, take off your prosthetics, jump on a mat, grab kids' legs, and take them down.
And that's exactly what you did.
Exactly. But I told him, you know, at first, nah, no thanks, wrestling just wasn't for me. But the great thing about Coach Crotto, the thing that made him really special was that he did not give up on me. He was so persistent. Yeah. Every single day he'd see me in the hallway in school, he'd ask me about wrestling. I'll be in my wheelchair, I'll try to wheel away from him really fast. Yeah. But he got a hold of me one day, brought me down to the practice room, started to demonstrate to me how I could wrestle, and I fell in love with the sport.
Wow. So you weren't even planning to wrestle. I mean, what sports did you want to play when you were a kid?
I wanted to play sports that I couldn't play, basically. You know, football, soccer, baseball. But thankfully, I found wrestling because of my coach.
Yeah. I mean, what was that first experience like for you to take somebody down?
It was difficult. It was challenging because, you know, I had to basically figure out techniques that I can do without the use of my legs. So once I found out those techniques, I was able to practice them, and I became pretty good over it.
And what was like the reaction from other people, like other classmates, when they saw you out there performing and taking guys down? Like that's like what's sticking in my head right now.
You know, just whenever I go to tournaments or go to matches back in high school and I would wrestle, I would always get a pretty good sized crowd around a mat watching wrestle and watch me do my thing. And people were always really supportive, not just my teammates and my coaches, but even kids from different schools and people from different towns. They would come up to me, they would shake my hand, they would say, well, watching you wrestle is so motivational, watching you wrestle is so inspirational.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it because I wasn't trying to inspire people. I wasn't trying to motivate people. I was just trying to be a kid myself and play a sport.
Yeah. I mean, prior to all of that, when you were a kid, you know, from the ages of 4 until that point in your life, I mean, what was the reaction of other kids in school?
In school, I kind of became popular, I guess, in school. You know, kids would come up to me, they'd say, hey, I heard you're wrestling without legs. That's amazing. That's awesome. I wish you the best of luck.
And
I became pretty popular, especially with the girls, you know. So it was a good thing.
That is a good thing.
Oh, yeah.
But then later on, you actually went into Penn State and you became a Division I wrestler.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I literally walked onto the Penn State wrestling team without any legs.
Wow.
Because I wasn't recruited. You know,
and the coach was kind of—he was a little skeptical. That coach, right? He didn't think that you could do this.
No, because he never heard of anyone wrestling as an amputee before. But I basically had to prove to him and show him that I could wrestle. Yeah. Thankfully enough, he was open-minded enough to give me a tryout. And I tried out, I made a team, thankfully, and the rest is history.
Wow. So what was so skeptical? Why was he so skeptical to first have you join the team? Because originally he wanted you to be like a bench assistant,
yeah,
right?
Like
and you weren't having that.
No. I want to be an athlete. You know, I've always been an athlete, and I told him I want to wrestle. I want to be on a Penn State wrestling team. Yeah. And he just wasn't sure how I could do it. So he asked me, Rohan, how could you wrestle without legs? I told him, it's hard to explain, but I could show you. Mm-hmm. He said, all right. So I took him down.
Wow.
Right in his office. After that, he said, all right, that's enough. And he gave me a trap at the Penn State wrestling team.
Wow. That's amazing. I mean, congratulations to you on all of this.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
And even in today's, like, what is your life like today?
Well, right now, I'm a motivational speaker. Mm-hmm. I speak to primarily middle schools, high schools, and colleges across the country. Tomorrow, I'll be heading to Kansas and speak at a high school out there.
Wow.
And I'm just trying to tell kids that just because you're dealt a bad hand in life, that doesn't mean you have to fold. It doesn't mean you have to give up. You have to persevere. You have to keep on going. You keep on striving for what you want to get out of life.
And that's your message to them.
Exactly.
Wow. So you really did. You are a story that you took a negative and you turned it into this huge positive.
Trying to be positive, yeah.
Yeah. No, it is positive. Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
You're living probably a life that somebody else in your shoes doesn't realize that they can live.
Yeah.
So this is a true positive. I mean, when you got up in front of a crowd, what's the biggest crowd you think you've spoken in front of so far?
Biggest audience ever? Maybe 2,000 people.
Wow.
That was at Lincoln Southwest High School in Lincoln, Nebraska.
Uh-huh.
I also spoke to maybe close to 2,000 people at the NSA conference, National Starting Association Conference in Washington, D.C. this past summer. And for me, that was pretty special because growing up, always had a bad stuttering problem, always had a bad speech impediment.
Right.
So for me to overcome that speech impediment, that stuttering problem, to become a motivational speaker, that's pretty special.
Do you ever get nervous?
Oh, yeah, definitely, all the time. I'm nervous now. It's part of business.
I mean, you are so well accomplished for somebody in this type of situation. And also, we do have some video footage, which we'll be showing you throughout the course of this segment as well, so people can actually see, you know, what you can do out there.
Thank you.
And also, you are one of the founders of the Murphy Mat,
it's called.
Tell us about that. We have it here in front of you. If you'd like, I'll help you hold it up.
Thanks.
Can show the audience.
Appreciate it. It's basically a mat that teaches kids how to do push-ups, and I really just want to get this in every PE class across the country. I really think this would be a great tool for kids to use every day to help build upper body strength and become, you know, pretty good shape, like myself.
Yeah, how long did it take you to get that size? I mean, look at those arms and shoulders. I mean, that's like three of my arms.
Years of doing push-ups, just like what's on this mat. So if kids do this, they'll be there in a couple of years.
Absolutely. So what is the most that you can bench press, actually?
The most I can bench press right now, my best lift ever, is 350 pounds.
Wow.
Yeah. My goal someday is to get 400, so
yeah,
still got a long way to go.
And when you were trying out for wrestling, actually, you did probably the most pull-ups out of the entire school, right?
Yeah. Actually, back in middle school, when I met my phys ed teacher who told me about the sport of wrestling, he had me do some pull-ups, and right then and there, I set the school record for pull-ups.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So cool. And I mean, if you don't mind, we can revisit back to your childhood a little bit. I mean, what was the reaction of other students to you when you were in school when they saw that you had this disability prior to doing your wrestling? I mean, were you discriminated against at all?
No, not at all. You know, one of the big problems now as a youth speaker that I see every day going to schools is bullying.
Mm-hmm.
There are tons of bullying out there. And I tell kids all the time that when I was younger, when I was going through middle school and high school, I was never bullied. I was never made fun of because I didn't have legs. And that was something that I was really afraid of. But thankfully, the people in my community, East Islip, they really accepted me for who I was.
But I'm sure people approached you and said, you know, how come you're in a wheelchair?
Yeah.
How did you handle that?
Yeah, I mean, when I was younger, probably in grade school, I would lash out at them. I would tell them, don't worry about it, it's none of your business. But as I got older, I learned to accept that. And it's only human nature to be curious about what you don't see every day. And obviously, not seeing someone without legs is, you know.
Was there ever a time in your life that you were angry because of this situation?
Yeah, definitely. More so when I was younger in grade school.
Mm-hmm.
But I really think that turning point for me in my life was in eighth grade, meeting Coach Croteau, him telling me about the sport of wrestling and being able to wrestle and really just be an athlete. And that changed my life forever.
Wow. That's so amazing.
Yeah.
And then here you are. I mean, you're actually still a fitness instructor, right? You teach at the Gold's Gym, actually, in East Islip.
In Islip. Yeah,
wow.
Yeah. Gold's Gym. I'm a trainer there. Uh-huh. I don't really train too often, to be honest with you, because I'm always so busy speaking and traveling for speaking. But they're nice enough to give me a free membership as well, so they're a sponsor.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Very cool. So what are some of the classes that, do you teach classes as well or just?
Not anymore.
No?
Because of speaking, but I'm certified for spinning and cranking.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Oh, that's the arm bike, right?
Exactly.
I had to do that after a car accident 5 years ago. Yeah. That actually built a lot of strength in my shoulder.
Definitely. It's a great workout.
Prior to doing this, I used to be an aerobics instructor as well.
And okay.
I used to have like the time of my life up there in front of the classes. I mean, I've always been an audience type person.
Yeah, yeah.
And you sort of are now too.
Yeah,
I mean, you're always getting up in front of audiences.
Yeah,
and you've spoken over 37 states to date. Wow.
And tomorrow, my first time in Kansas, so that'll make 38.
That's amazing. So you're going to complete the map pretty soon.
Hopefully. I don't know. Getting to Alaska, that's going to be a challenge.
And in recent years, you've also been part of Nike's No Excuses commercials because of your Just Do It attitude.
Yeah.
Tell us about that experience.
Oh, back in 2008, I was lucky enough to get invited down to a casting call where I got interviewed by a couple different Nike executives, and they wanted to know if I was chosen to be in this commercial, what exactly could I do? Mm-hmm. So I kind of just did my thing for them. I did some push-ups, did some other little aerobic type stuff that I'm known for doing, and luckily enough, they chose me for the commercial, and I went out to L.A., first class, by the way.
Wow.
And I filmed the commercial at a local high school in L.A., and it was a great moment for me. It was a dream come true, you know, growing up watching all my favorite athletes on their Nike commercials, like Michael Jordan, Jerry Rice, and being able to have my own is pretty special.
Did you ever think that this would be what your life is now? Did you ever picture this for yourself?
No way. You know, I'm just so blessed to have the life that I have, the career that I have as a speaker. Uh-huh. Now I'm getting into other ventures like the Murphy Mat. So I'm looking forward to what the future holds.
Yeah, and how long has the Murphy Mat been out on the market?
Oh, we just put this out maybe a couple weeks ago.
Wow.
So it's brand spanking new.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow, that's
brand
amazing.
New. Yeah.
And have you demonstrated with this when you go to schools to the younger kids?
Yeah, now that just came out, I have. So we're doing more schools, getting it out there.
They must be so fascinated with you. I mean, it's one thing to talk to adults. I mean, I think your story is amazing, too, because like I said earlier, so many people that are probably in your predicament don't even think any of this is possible and kind of lose hope, whereas you're the complete opposite.
Yeah.
So what is it like to see these kids' faces when you go in and you do all these demonstrations for them that they probably wouldn't imagine you ever doing?
Yeah, you know, it's a great feeling being able to inspire kids, get the most out of life. I get a lot of great feedback from kids, whether it's in person at the school after I'm done presenting, or even when I go home on my social networks, like a Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, at Rohan Murphy, by the way. kids reach out to me. They tell me how much they enjoy my presentation, how much I inspired them. So really is just a great feeling to
Have
do
you
that.
Ever had the chance to meet some of your idols in doing all of this?
A couple.
Yeah.
You know, a couple weeks ago, I was able to meet Doc Gooden. Former pitcher for New York Mets.
Wow.
That was pretty cool. Back in high school, through someone who worked at News A, Greg Sauer, who's a News A reporter for them, he had me have the opportunity to meet Patrick Ewing when he was on the New York Knicks.
Wow.
So that was pretty cool.
This is so cool.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you were a child growing up, what did you envision for yourself at this point in your life?
Growing up, I always just had a vision for myself. I had a vision that I was going to do something positive with my life, that I was going to accomplish something great, and that when I got older, I was going to be somebody. And I've had my rough moments growing up, but I just never gave up.
Right.
You know, I just wanted to succeed. And I tell kids all the time that in life, there is no elevator to success. You want to do something meaningful, you want to do something special with your life, eventually, you have to take the stairs. And what I mean by that is eventually, you have to overcome some type of adversity, some type of hardship or struggle. And obviously, I had to overcome this. And I know that if I could overcome this, I could overcome anything and be successful.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, did it take you a long time to adjust to this?
Well, this is all what I know. I don't know what it's like to have legs. So there really wasn't any adjustment for me.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, you can't miss anything that you never had, right?
Exactly.
So to speak.
Yeah.
Wow, excellent. I mean, when you're doing your motivational speeches, I mean, like, what goes through your mind as you're giving them and you're looking over all of this audience?
When I speak, I kind of just get in that zone.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain, but I'm just so focused and I'm just trying to speak clearly. I'm trying to really connect with my audience.
Mm-hmm.
And I do a lot of demonstrations to keep kids' attention because, you know, kids, they can have a short attention spans.
Yeah.
So I'm doing a lot of demonstrations.
So it's fun to watch.
Exactly. So it really is like a little presentation. It's like a mini show that I do for the kids. I walk my hands. I do some push-ups. I do a takedown demonstration, how I would take some down. Kids love that. Especially when I take down the principal.
And, they love that,
oh,
I'm
yeah,
sure.
definitely. Payback, you know? And it's just a great feeling to go out there and to be able to not just motivate the kids and the students and audience, but to motivate the teachers and adults in the crowd as well.
Wow, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you were a child, I mean, what was your dream job? What did you want to be when you were young?
My dream job? I wasn't sure.
Yeah.
I really didn't know because I was really worried about not having legs when I was younger, and I always asked myself, what could I do if I don't have legs? What could be my profession?
Yeah.
I know being a police officer was out of the question, be a firefighter, stuff like that.
Right.
And I got into motivational speaking because my college wrestling coach at Penn State University, Troy Sunlin, he told me about motivational speaking. He would have me give speeches at camps every summer. And I told him, wow, this is pretty cool. And I think, you know what, coach, I could do this for a living. Yeah. So I started to reach out to different high schools and middle schools on Long Island, started to become pretty well-known around Long Island for speaking, and then started to branch out, do different schools in other states. So it's been pretty amazing.
So how do you get into the other states? I mean, as of tomorrow, you'll do 38 states. Mm-hmm. How does that happen?
Media, just like this, you know, being on TV helps.
Okay.
Thank you for having me. any type of newspaper article,
right?
You know, social media, that's a big key nowadays. I book speeches literally through Instagram.
Wow.
Because I'll go speak at a school, a kid would like my page or like one of my pictures on Instagram, one of his friends would see it from a different school in another state, he'll bring it to their principal and tell them about me, and the principal will get in contact with me.
Wow.
It's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, you truly are an inspiration, and no doubt you brought some hope out to some of our audience today.
Thank you.
It is about time for us to go, but Rohan, I do want to say thank you so much.
Thanks for having
me. An honor to meet
you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And if you'd like to know more about Rohan, visit his website. Do you have a website you could give the audience?
Yeah, www.rohanmurphy.com. And of course, social media, Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, at my name, Rohan Murphy.
Excellent. Rohan, thank you once again for joining us. I'm Jason Galka, and I thank you at home for joining us on The Daily Blue. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.